Hi, I'm Buriana and you're watching Art Unplugged. This video is about Titian's masterpiece Bacchus and Ariadne, a painting so loaded with drama, musicality, action, even humor, that it deserves to win an Emmy Award for musical comedy. In the 16th century Italy, the Renaissance was in full swing. New wealth was being generated, new ideas were circulating. After centuries of Christian preaching about guilt, shame, doom and gloom, the affluent classes were developing a taste for the fine things in life and appropriately wanted to have some sophisticated entertainment. And if you are the ultra-rich Duke of Ferrara and there is no Netflix, what do? You commission Titian to paint you a mythological scene. And he delivers you an award-winning show. Titian is one of the greatest painters of the Italian Renaissance and the most prominent master of the Venetian school. He rose to fame around 1518 when he painted Assumption of the Virgin. Soon after that, he was creating works for leading members of the royalty, including dukes, kings, and even the Pope. Titian was equally good at all genres and developed a distinct style, which was very different from the tendency of the time to paint the figures with elongated necks in somewhat pretentious postures. Titian believed that this style, known as mannerism, lacked emotional authenticity, so he made exactly that the priority in his work. Titian painted Bacchus and Ariadne for Alfonso, the Duke of Ferrara, between 1521 and 23. It was a particularly important commission for him. By then, he was already established as Venice's leading painter. So this was his chance to showcase his talent outside of Venice and expand his clientele. When it came to entertainment in the Renaissance, the number one content provider was the Greek mythology. An endless soap opera full of sex scandals, heroes and villains, naughty gods and goddesses who mess around with the mortals, creating all sorts of trouble. So, what is the plot of Bacchus and Ariadne? Princess Ariadne, daughter of the Cretan king Minos, falls in love with the hero Theseus and helps him kill the Minotaur, a bloodthirsty beast, half man, half bull, that her father kept in the labyrinth. She provided Theseus with a ball of thread which helped him trace his way in the labyrinth. Theseus, however, abandons her while she sleeps on the Greek island of Naxos. There is this thing with heroes sometimes, yes. Heartbroken, Ariadne is wandering along the shore, watching her lover's ship vanish on the horizon, when she's surprised by the wine god Bacchus and his drunken party. Bacchus falls in love at first sight and proposes to Ariadne right away, offering her as a wedding gift the sky, in which one day she would become a constellation. Now, we can easily imagine an opening scene with Ariadne alone on the beach, singing a tearful ballad about her lost love. I can't live if living is without you. I can't give. I can't give anymore. And then, whoosh, enters the choir. Change of mood, change of color. Just look at this. We can hear the beat of dancing feet, the cymbals and the tambourines, the din and the racket of the approaching gang of party animals. And tell me that Titian did not invent this phrase. It is not by chance that so many animals are not only present, but intertwined with the human figures here. How did Titian express the suddenness of their entry? Well, we are accustomed to reading images from left to right and therefore anticipate change to occur from that direction. When it happens the other way around, we are surprised. Just compare. doesn't this scene seem more predictable this way? And indeed, the story otherwise unravels from the left of the picture to the right, with the disappearing sail of Theseus's ship in the horizon and the overturned vase, symbol of lost love. There are two storylines in this painting, the love story and the party story. Titian shows us that by dividing the canvas diagonally. On the upper left is the story of romantic love. This is the domain of the spiritual and the divine, bathing in shimmering light and dominated by big blue skies. Opposite to it is the domain of the visceral, the unromantic story of excess and carnal pleasures, painted in earthly tones, crowded and chaotic, where even the sky is obscured by thick forests. Titian is famous for his masterful use of color, and this was not down to his painterly skill alone. As the official painter of the Venetian Republic, he had many privileges, including access to rare pigments, demonstrated here in the generous use of the really expensive azurite blue, the bright reds and greens. Of course, because of aging, what we see today is a fraction of the original brilliance of Titian's canvases. There is even a color named after him, Titian Red. The rusty orange hue became all the rage in Venice at the time. Women dyed their hair to mimic the look of the redhead beauties in his paintings. In Bacchus and Ariadne, Titian incorporated various action lines to create movement in the scene and to support the plot. Ariadne and Bacchus, with their interlocked eyes and mirroring body language, seem engaged in a celestial dance, an effect made stronger by the sinuous lines that prevail on the left side of the painting. On the opposite side, the descending diagonals and the arching line above them act like a crushing wave. The drunken group may seem unruly and chaotic, but their movement is well choreographed by Titian. Notice the underlying rhythm of the limbs, the faces and movements that spell out crude humor and sexual innuendo. The soloist of the group is of course Bacchus, the god of wine and debauchery, in his chariot pulled by two cheetahs. A bit of a strange deviation from the two lions in his classical representation. Most researchers believe that Titian used animals from Alfonso's private zoo as models. However, one of the sources I used for this video offers an interesting alternative explanation. Titian was assisting the Duke's ambassador to shop for antiques and rare objects in Venice. The wish list included cheetahs or leopards, which they could not find. So, following his good customer service instinct, Titian replaced the lions with cheetahs in the painting as a consolatory gesture. But let's return to the show, where a lovey-dovey duet of Bacchus and Ariadne falling in love is about to begin. But before that, a little satyr boy takes the front stage. Notice that he is the only character looking at the viewer. Very much in the manner of Puck from Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream, he addresses the audience directly, announcing the main act. Now the spotlight is on the duet of Bacchus and Ariadne. It is the culmination of the drama, a turning point in the story, which Titian suggests with a number of twists and swirls in the figures. Look at Bacchus. His arms are still turned to his followers, but the rest of his body is facing Ariadne. He is literally walking on air. The artist and show director Titian expressed so well his in-between state of flying and falling, of drunkenness and sobriety, which arguably describes the moment of losing your head over a girl. His red cloak is flapping in the wind. This is the flame of love that has just come alight. We can hear him say, "Honey, I promise to give up the booze and join a gym. And do you see those diamonds in the sky? They will all be yours." On her part, Ariadne is in a whirlpool of conflicting emotions. While her body is still facing the sea, her face is turned to Bacchus. In fact, she's already stepping back with her right foot. And doesn't the gesture of her hand seem as if she's pushing away the memory of Theseus? Yes, he may be hot and have a six-pack, but turned out to be a pig and stood her up. On the other hand, this new guy seems fun, and he is a god after all. And what girl can say no to all these diamonds? Oh, and even the two cheetahs seem mesmerized by each other like our two protagonists. What is a musical comedy without a pinch of humor, right? According to the myth, Ariadne turned Bacchus down three times before she said yes, perhaps hinted by the three loops of her red sash. Then they got married and lived happily ever after. Curtain. And for the record, girls, he didn't give up the booze and join a gym after all.
Ooh.
You've been warned. Before I go, in my favorite art blog, there is an excellent in-depth analysis of this painting, full of discoveries which you will not find anywhere else. It is a great read. I recommend it, and I've included a link in the description below. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please like, share, and subscribe with the bell so that you can receive notifications of my future videos. If you want to see my work as an artist, you can follow me on my social media. All the links are in the description below. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you very soon. Bye.